lady then 28 years old and the unmarried daughter of the first Marquis of Hastings was given the position of lady-in-waiting to the future Queen Victoria's mother, the Duchess of Kent, in 1834. It was 3 years before Victoria was crowned Queen. Victoria's mother employed John Conroy to take care of her and the rest of the family. He was instrumental in developing the Kensington system, a plan that would leave the young Victoria subjected to a new set of rules and regulations designed to make her completely reliant on her mother and Conroy. Luckily for Victoria, she refused any such guidance, however much they sought to convince her. As one of her first official acts as monarch, Victoria ordered her mother and Conroy into separate quarters. But Victoria also developed a strong mistrust of several of the Kensington Palace staff, in particular one of her mother's ladies, and one that would cause a massive scandal at the time. So join me now as we look back at the life of Lady Flora Hastings, and please like the video and consider subscribing for more historical stories. Victoria detested Sir John Conroy, the comptroller of the Duchess's household. She referred to him as a monster and the devil incarnate. Yet it was rumoured that he was her mother's lover. Flora Hastings was brought into this circle of hatred, and her job was to be Victoria's companion. A continual presence was intended to minimise the number of Victoria's close friends. Flora made the journey to London from her birthplace in Scotland, where she had been raised, in January 1839, escorted by Sir John Conroy. But even at this early stage, Flora had been experiencing nausea and vomiting for several weeks and abdominal pain. When she arrived in London on January the 10th, her first order of business was to meet with Sir James Clark, the court physician to Queen Victoria and the Duchess of Kent. He recommended treatments consisting of rhubarb and camphor, but they were ineffective. However, Flora shared with her uncle Hamilton Fitzgerald that by means of walking and porter, I restored a little strength, and that when I did so, the swelling receded to a most surprising degree. But the swelling, however, was something that the Queen's ladies had also witnessed. On February the 2nd, Victoria wrote in her journal that Flora's form looked very suspicious, and that both she and Lazen, Queen's governess, were certain that Flora was with child, and that Clark was unable to disprove the suspicion. Victoria asserted that the reviled Conroy was the biological father of the made-up child she conceived. Flora Hastings was caught in the crossfire of Victoria's early court, which was rife with infighting and rivalries between various factions. Yet Flora was not only an exceptional poet and linguist, but she also possessed a quick wit, with Lazen often being the subject of her ridicule. Flora's portraits depict her as an alluring young lady of slim build. However, when Victoria ascended to the throne, Lord Melbourne, the Prime Minister, referred to her as the ugliest woman he had ever seen, and Victoria referred to her as that nasty woman. In addition, the Queen and the court were fervent supporters of the Whig government. One contemporary observer wrote that a conservative cat was not permitted to mew in the precincts of the palace, because the Queen and the court supported the Whig government, although the Hastings family were full of conservative support. Being unmarried with a child was taboo back in those days, yet the rumours continued. A couple of weeks after first being seen by Clark, he had informed Flora that due to her swollen stomach, even the Queen's ladies were convinced that she must either be privately married, or at least ought to be so, at which point he urged her to confess. Flora's terrified mother described the notion as this most terrible proposal. After Clark strenuously told her that there was only one option, that was to satisfy the ladies with her innocence, and this would be to agree to a medical examination. It was in response to Flora's firm denial that she had not done anything wrong, although distressing news for the Queen, who by now was feeling the pressure, but agreed Flora could not return to court unless and until the event in question was resolved. Flora had no choice. Sir James Clark and Sir Charles Clark, the family physician for the Hastings, were the two doctors involved. Flora's Swiss maid, who was in tears during the proceedings, was also present. The Duchess of Bedford, who Flora referred to as my accuser, was one of Victoria's ladies and was also present. The doctor signed a certificate after the examination stating there are no grounds for assuming pregnancy, currently present, or ever has been. It was relief for Flora, who wrote a letter to her brother, the Marquis of Hastings, on February the 19th. She told him her honour had been most basely assailed. Hastings, suffering from influenza at the time, still wrote to London from his home in Leicestershire and insisted from Melbourne that he be granted an audience with the Queen. He was given promises from her that Flora would be treated with honour and kindness and that she would once again be welcome at court, but she stopped short at providing any further information. The Hastings family desired an apology to be made public. In addition, they demanded that the person who started the rumour be identified and that Sir James Clark be removed from his position as the physician to the Queen, but none of that materialised as expected. It was explained to Flora's brother that if he brought up the issue in the House of Lords, it would be quashed because it was considered an assault on the throne. Regarding the possibility of legal action, they were informed there were no grounds for it. Because of this, the Hastings family had only one option left, to make a plea to the general public. Flora concluded her heartfelt and poignant letter to her uncle, Hamilton Fitzgerald, by saying, "Goodbye, my darling uncle. I feel sick to the stomach as I send you such a horrible story, but I wanted you to know the complete truth, and you are free to tell it to anybody you want, whenever you want." And he did. We cannot determine whether Flora intended for him to continue, but he did forward her letter to the Examiner, which then published the entire script. It caused a flood of newsprint to be produced, with extreme political connotations, using both Flora's personal anguish and harm done to the Queen. The argument became a political battle between the Whig Party supporting the Queen against the Tory Party for Flora. It was even suggested that Victoria was the one who circulated the rumours. The public took their anger to the streets and at royal events. Victoria knew she had ruffled feathers, but this scandal was not about to go away anytime soon. In April, the Marchioness Dowager of Hastings, Flora's mother, took the unprecedented step of publishing her contentious letters with Melbourne to the Morning Post. Victoria's outrage led her to rant and rave against that wicked, foolish old woman. The Queen continued to respond in her journal, where she wrote, "I wish the editor and the whole of the Hastings family had been hanged for their infamy." On the other hand, Flora was now unable to leave the court, therefore she was deprived of the chance to relax or heal. She then experienced a terrible decline in her weight and her hair began to fall out. By June, her condition had deteriorated to the point where she could not even leave her room. Flora was seen by the Queen just a few days before she passed away, and the Queen wrote in her journal that Flora appeared to be as thin as somebody can be who is still alive, literally a skeleton. I told her that I hoped to see her again when she was feeling better, and in response she grabbed hold of my hand as though to say, "I shall not see you again." The death of Flora occurred on July the 5th, 1839, around 2 o'clock in the morning. She was just 33 years old. Because the sentiments around this affair were so intense, in the final days of her life, Flora herself insisted on a post-mortem and for the results to be published in every detail. Flora wanted the world to know she was innocent, and the results of the post-mortem vindicated her last appeal. Shortly after, Conroy and Flora's brother began a smear campaign against Queen Victoria and her doctors for spreading the rumours, which would ultimately damage the Queen's popularity. However, the rumour which had begun with Lazen and the Duchess of Bedford confiding in Conroy was just a ruse to attempt to portray the young queen as one who required leadership and that only he could provide this. Victoria's popularity rose again in 1840 after her marriage to Prince Albert and the birth of their first child, Princess Victoria. Flora's brother, who felt helpless about the situation, ended up publishing a pamphlet that included all the relevant documents. It reached an incredible 7 editions in the span of just 6 months. It is difficult to conceive a situation that would bring more shame to an unwed, aristocratic woman and her family. Yet the results of the autopsy revealed the reality, which was that Flora had been battling a liver condition before her passing. As for Queen Victoria, she recalled only 4 incidents during her lengthy reign that gave her recurring nightmares. The passing of Prince Albert being one, but quite possibly a more horrific addition to her sleepless nights, was that of Lady Flora Hastings.